What are Dr. Ross's top five critical security controls?
Well, you're killing me on this because there's a long history of the use of critical controls. My good friend, Alan Paller, who passed away not too long ago, he and I used to have a running battle about security controls. He would say, you know, I love your catalog, but it's got too much stuff in it. He said, can't you prioritize those darn controls instead of having 2,000 to look at, just prioritizing? Well, we fought that for years. We had good public debates about it. It was always in good spirits and everything. But as time went on, we actually did put priority codes in 853. We had the priority codes were 1, 2, or 3. I think we had a 0 code as well. And then Alan, under the SANS Institute, ended up developing the 20 critical controls, and that became very, very popular. And those controls were reflected in the NIST catalog of 853 controls. But his idea was to look at, people can't be overwhelmed with all the complexity of the catalog. They got to start somewhere. So he said, this is what we're going to do. And I fought it for years on. But then over time, I said, you know, that's probably a good idea, because there are a lot of things to do and we need to do that. So now you've made my challenge even more difficult, because instead of 20, you're asking me for 5. So, but I'll answer that in the context of our discussion today. Certainly, it's very difficult to come up with 5. But if you had to put me up against the wall and make me do that, I would say number one would be a control on security architecture and making sure that you get your arms around your system and your security architecture, because that gets to the heart of complexity, the zero trust discussion we had today, basically getting your arms around what you have to deal with as far as your enterprise. Now, right after that, I would say, and this kind of goes hand in hand with the first couple of 20 critical controls in the SANS that they had published years after, configuration management and control. In other words, having an inventory of everything on your system and your network, all the software applications, all the network devices, because if it's not being managed and you don't know about it, that could be an attack vector that is totally off your radar. That would be number two. The third one would be consistent, again, with reducing and managing complexity, least functionality, getting rid of every port, protocol, service, application, anything that's not essential for carrying out your missions and business operations, get rid of it. It's hard to do sometimes, but it's part of that discipline and structure of the basic blocking and tackling that you have to have in order to get your arms around that problem and reduce the attack surface. Mm-hmm. Right on the heels of that would be least privilege. Only give privileges, especially privileged access. Only give that to people who absolutely need to have that for mission business operations. And we see that violated all the time. People have way too many privileges, and especially when you come to things that are very sensitive, that needs to be even a smaller and smaller trusted set of individuals, because again, it's like expanding your attack surface. Every new individual on there with privileges, more attack surface, more things that can go wrong. That's number four. Number five would be, strong access control and authentication and authorization. That's part of that zero trust we talked about. When you have that zero trust concepts and principles, and you've got that architecture defined, and you have all the components defined, now you want to apply strong access control authorization to those smaller, more well-managed security domains. Mm-hmm. And then if I can get one bonus, one bonus control, it would be that contingency plan or that incident response plan. A lot of people put that down on the priority list, but one thing you can be guaranteed, if your system has not been breached up to this point, you can guarantee that it will be breached sometime in the future, maybe at a time when you don't expect. Get that contingency plan written and make sure it's exercised. You know, tabletop exercises, go through, and in the Army, we used to have a saying, you fight in combat as you train. So that Army training you go through every day becomes like it's on autopilot. When a cyber attack happens, you're basically sliding down that pole and you're like on autopilot. So you can't be going and reading that contingency plan or that incident response plan the first time after the incident happens. It has to be part of your culture, the way you do business, exercise and train, and you know what's going on, because if you're doing it for the first time, you will not execute. It's not going to have a great outcome. That's my bonus recommendation.
Thank you. Well, I guess if you see across the web, Dr. Ross's top five, you'll know where it came from, I suppose.